I realize that in speaking to you this afternoon, there are certain limitations placed upon the right of free speech. I must be exceedingly careful, prudent as to what I say, and even more careful and prudent as to how I say it. I may not be able to say all I think, but I am not going to say anything that I do not think.
On June 16, 1918, socialist Eugene Debs spoke to a crowd in Canton, Ohio, articulating his opposition to the First World War. 2 weeks later, Debs was arrested and charged with 10 counts of sedition under the recently passed Espionage and Sedition Acts. In the uneasy context of World War I, Eugene Debs' arrest added to the tension between national security and civil liberties, a struggle constant throughout all of American history that only becomes more heated during wartime. In 1894, Eugene Debs was arrested for his participation in the Pullman strike, in which he organized the American Railway Union, the largest union of its time, claiming 150,000 members by 1895. While serving his time in prison, Debs received and read socialist literature, and after his 1895 release, Debs helped to co-found the Socialist Party of America, running as their presidential candidate in the elections of 1904, 1908, and 1912. An incredibly charismatic speaker, Debs would often earn money by traveling the country giving socialist speeches. In 1912, Debs gave a speech to a sold-out crowd at Madison Square Garden, who gave him a 29-minute standing ovation after his speech. In April of 1917, the United States entered World War I, breaking President Woodrow Wilson's campaign promise to keep America out of the war. The decision was unpopular among a handful of Americans, and in June, Congress passed the Espionage Act of 1917, a bill designed to punish anti-war protesters and to maintain support for the war and the draft. 11 months later, Congress passed the Sedition Act of 1918, an extension of the Espionage Act. The new law helped restrict verbal opposition, outlawing the use of disloyal, profane, scurrilous, or abusive language regarding the United States government or military. After his 1912 campaign, Debs' health began to deteriorate, and he stopped traveling the country. Unable to earn money through his speeches, Debs began writing editorials that were published in socialist newspapers throughout the country. However, with the passage of the Sedition Act, many radical newspapers shut down, and Debs was forced to go back out on the road in order to make ends meet, despite not having recovered fully. On June 16, 1918, a month after the passage of the Sedition Act, Debs made a speech in Canton, Ohio, painting the war not as one to make the world safe for democracy, but one to make wealthy Americans wealthier.
Every solitary one of these aristocratic conspirators and would-be murderers claims to be an arch patriot. Every one of them insists that the war is being waged to make the world safe for democracy. What humbug, what rot, what false pretense! The working class who fight all the battles have never yet had a voice in either declaring war or making peace. It is the ruling class that invariably does both. They alone declare war, and they alone make peace. Yours not to reason why, yours but to do and die. That is their motto, and we object on the part of the awakening workers of this nation. If war is right, let it be declared by the people. You who have your lives to lose, you certainly, above all others, have the right to decide the momentous issue of war or peace.
Two weeks after his speech in Canton, Ohio, Debs was arrested and charged with 10 counts of sedition. In his trial, Debs addressed the court in his own defense for 2 hours.
Your Honor, I am opposing a social order in which it is possible for one man who does absolutely nothing that is useful to amass a fortune of hundreds of millions of dollars, while millions of men and women who work all the days of their lives secure barely enough for a wretched existence. The people are awakening. In due course of time, they will come into their own. I am now prepared to receive your sentence.
Debs was found guilty on all 10 counts. In his decision, Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes said that the Debs decision was essentially the same as the decision made earlier in Schenck versus the United States, in which the court ruled that both the Espionage Act and the Sedition Act were constitutional. In the Schenck decision, Holmes famously set the precedent of a clear and present danger by saying,
"The most stringent protection of free speech would not protect a man in falsely shouting fire in a theater and causing a panic. The question in every case is whether the words are of such a nature as to create a clear and present danger that they will bring about the evils that Congress has a right to prevent."
Every once in a while, there are people who are capable of going to trial and putting the whole society on trial. They sort of shift the focus from their own guilt and get the whole country to think about the law itself and justice. And Debs was able to do that, partly because he was a great speaker, and partly because everybody, even people who didn't like Debs' politics, most of them recognized that he was a sincere player on the American political scene, that he was working, had devoted his whole life to trying to make the country better. So when people saw him going to prison, many people felt the government had gone too far.
Debs received 10 years in prison. From his jail cell in Atlanta, Georgia, Debs ran for president in 1920, winning almost 1 million write-in votes, the highest a socialist candidate had ever received. Throughout all of American history, there has been a constant tension between national security and civil liberties, and this tension often takes a toll on the rights of American citizens. In 1798, the Federalist Party passed the Alien and Sedition Acts, essentially making it illegal for anyone to voice opinions contrary to the Federalists. The law was the first sedition act in American history, and it served as a template for the acts passed during World War I. 60 years later, civil war broke out in the United States, and President Abraham Lincoln needed a way to curb opposition in the North to win the war in the South. To do this, Congress passed the Habeas Corpus Suspension Act of 1863, allowing the president to suspend the writ of habeas corpus during wartime. The law sought to improve national security, but in doing so, also infringed on the civil liberties of many American citizens. 80 years after that, a second world war erupted in Europe, and the U.S. again entered. In order to moderate opposition to the war, the U.S. government established the Office of Censorship in 1941. The head of the Office of Censorship, Byron Price, was awarded a Pulitzer Prize in 1944 for his work in censorship. 20 more years, and America found itself in the middle of the most unpopular war in its history, Vietnam. In 1968, the Supreme Court ruled in U.S. v. O'Brien that the burning of draft cards is not protected by the First Amendment, and in 1970, students were shot at by the Ohio National Guard at Kent State University for protesting the war, resulting in the death of 4 students. 30 years later, the September 11th attacks shocked the entire world, forever changing American policies on national security. A month later, the Bush administration passed the controversial Patriot Act, a law designed to prevent similar attacks, and in doing so, brought the question of national security and civil liberties into the 21st century. A decade later, in 2010, Julian Assange was arrested for leaking thousands of US government cables. Assange was arrested for leaking information relating to the national defense and giving the US government reason to believe the information could be used to the injury of the United States or to the advantage of any foreign nation. These quotes come from the Espionage Act of 1917, which the US government cited in their arrest of Assange. Although passed almost 100 years earlier to maintain public support during war, the law has never been repealed and is still being used to enhance national security at the expense of civil liberties. From Eugene Debs to Julian Assange, lines can be drawn throughout American history connecting those whose civil liberties were diminished because they were considered to be a threat to national security.
You and I are much more free to stand on a street corner and say whatever we want about the government in a time of war than people were in Debs' day. And it's because of Debs and because of the people who rallied to his support.
Thomas Jefferson once said, "A little rebellion now and then is a medicine necessary for the sound health of a government." This phrase especially rings true regarding the balance between national security and civil liberties, because without a little rebellion now and then, the civil liberties of all Americans would be diminished. Eugene Debs sought to maintain this idealistic balance, and despite his arrest and imprisonment, his own personal rebellion is a victory for every other person in American history who reacted to censorship as an upstander and not a bystander.